fourth dose for 15 days and 1 month respectively. History of presenting illness, the patient was apparently normal 6 months ago, after which he developed a pain over the left lower limb, which was cramping in type, more over the calf region, which was non-radiating, initially present after walking for a distance of about 500 meters, with which the patient managed to walk without taking rest. Now, for the past 3 months, patient has developed pain at rest over the left calf. Rest pain reduces by hanging legs down or sitting. Patient sleeps with legs hanging down. No aggravation of pain on exposure to warm or cold water. History of blackish discoloration noted by the patient over the left fourth toe since 1 month, followed by left third toe since 15 days. Initially started over the tip of both toes, now has gradually progressed to involve the entire distal phalanx of fourth toe and has remained at the tip of the third toe. It is associated with pain and no history of discharge. History of sleep disturbances present, no history of trauma, no history of paresthesia over lower limbs, no history of fever, or no history of swelling or redness of lower limbs. No history of postprandial abdominal pain, loss of weight or melena, no history of blurring of vision, no history of syncopal attacks or blackouts, no history of chest pain, no history of weakness of limbs, or no history of visual disturbances, and no history of impotence. Past history, patient is a known case of diabetic, diabetes mellitus for 10 years on OHAs, tablet metformin, a known case of hypertension for the past 5 years on treatment, no history of previous similar episodes, no history of coronary artery disease, bronchial asthma, pulmonary tuberculosis, epilepsy or valvular heart disease, no history of previous exposure to coal causing appearance of symptoms, no history of previous surgical interventions or vascular interventions. Personal history, patient is a chronic smoker for the past 45 years, smoking 1 pack of cigarettes per day, having 45 pack years, smokes 20 cigarettes per day, giving a smoke index of 900. Chronic alcoholic for the past 40 years. Patient sleeps with legs hanging down for relief of pain and sleep disturbances present. Family history, no family history of diabetes, hypertension, CAD or any atherosclerosis. Drug history, history of chronic consumption of analgesics since the appearance of symptoms, no other significant histories. Summary, a 60-year-old male patient, known diabetic and hypertensive, and a chronic smoker with complaints of claudication pain over left calf, followed by development of rest pain and gangrene over the left third and fourth toes, possibly a case of peripheral vascular disease.
Just go to the second. Okay, let's stick with summary. A little trick question. Define chronic smoker.
Patient who smokes.
I'm asking you this question particularly because you have mentioned pack years. When you mention 45 pack per year or something like that, you have mentioned.
Yes, sir.
What does it mean?
Sir, 1 pack per year, 1 pack per day for a continuous 1 year.
So that's 365 packets per day. Where does that figure 45 come from?
Sir, 1 pack per day. For continuous 1 year, makes 1 pack year.
Acha, so 1 pack year is one defined pack. As, and one suppose pack. Suppose one day he did not smoke, now what happens?
Sir?
I'm just pulling your leg. It is not included in the examination at all. The bottom line is, do not talk of anything that will attract attention of an examiner for no reason. You understand? He's a chronic smoker, smoking 1 pack per day is enough to define him as examiner.
Yes,
moment
sir.
You put in some word like pack year, etc., etc. See, I was almost sleeping. I got up saying that, oh, there is something new which I don't know. Let me have also, you say all examiners become examiners to gain latest knowledge, which only you can give. So I am here learning what is a pack year. And now, if you do not answer what is a pack year, if you answer what is a pack year, my ego gets hurt. I did not know this terminology. So I have to keep on asking you question till you say I don't know. Simple. Define claudication.
Define claudication pain. What is claudication?
claudication is a limping pain or cramping
limping. Pain. Next question. Emperor or King Claudius? The word originates from Claudius.
Claudius, which means
I limp. I have not finished it. My question to you is, was he emperor or a king? Forget it. Just to give you an extra mark, whether you looked at the word, because if you have read the word Claudius, the prefix is always there. Okay, go ahead.
One thing you should understand, there is no acute chronic alcoholic. An alcoholic is a person who has been regularly drinking. No chronic alcoholism, acute alcoholism. An alcoholic is a person who keeps on drinking.
Yes,
unless we don't, occasional consumer is different. But an alcoholic is a person who keeps on drinking for years together. There's no acute alcoholic and then there's no chronic alcoholic. And other things you should know, when you present itself, all of you should know that this patient is a diabetic, hypertension, all those things are there. The only thing that carries should not come into the past history, it should be brought into the present history. If the patient, once you know patient has got a gangrene, then your mind should in the history ask whether you are a diabetic or a hypertensive. No, you should not bring it into the past history. This should not happen, understand? Because smoking and alcohol are very good partners, you know. And again, it's got a systemic hypertension. There's another third good friend joining them. Okay.
Again, it's better to mention in the beginning itself, patient had pain suggestive of claudication pain. In the beginning history itself, as a PG, you can say it straight away.
Yeah,
it's not like UG is building up the story too much. Straight away say claudication pain.
When a patient has wrist pain, gangrene, and claudication pain, you want to give us any other diagnosis? A peripheral vascular disease. What is that? What is critical limb ischemia?
Critical limb ischemia is short.
No, you go ahead now with your examination. We'll discuss it later. We got time short. Okay.
On general examination, after obtaining consent from the patient, he was examined in a well-lit room and comparing both limbs placed side by side. Patient is conscious, oriented, moderately built and nourished, with fair hydration. He's afebrile, no pallor, no icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, edema or generalized lymphadenopathy. Nicotine staining of the teeth was noted. There were no missing toes or fingers. Blood pressure was measured in both the upper limbs and it was 130/80 millimeters of mercury in the sitting position. Pulse rate was 80 beats per minute, regular rhythm, normal volume. The condition of the vessel wall is normal and there's no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. On local examination of the left lower limb, on inspection, the attitude of the limb was noted to be normal. No bony deformity, no restriction of movements at the toes, ankle, knee or hip joint on active movements. Patient had normal gait, no swelling or erythema of the lower limb noted, no marked change in color between both lower limbs noted on comparison, no staining along the course of superficial veins. Signs of ischemia were noted with thinning of skin, diminished hair growth, brittle nails, transverse ridges. There was no minor ulcerations over pressure areas and no muscle wasting was seen. On Berger's postural test, the Berger's angle was 30 degrees. Following the test on hanging the limbs by the side of the examination table, a cyanotic hue was noted over the left lower limb. Capillary filling time was delayed with 25 seconds and venous filling time was also delayed of 15 seconds. Venous guttering was seen on elevation of the limbs, which was not noted in the horizontal position. Gangrene noted over the left third and fourth toe. Third toe dry gangrene was noted over the tip of the toe, while fourth toe dry gangrene was noted extending up to proximal interphalangeal joint, mummified appearance with a line of demarcation at the level of the proximal interphalangeal joint. No skip lesions were noted over the left lower limb. On palpation, there was no significant change in temperature noted over the entire lower limb along its length and also with comparison to the opposite limb. No tenderness noted, no crepitus, no pedal edema. Capillary refilling time was increased. Harvey's sign of venous refilling, there was poor filling noted. Fuchs test for left lower limb, there was no oscillatory movement seen. Gangrene, dry in nature, hard and mummified, suggestive of dry gangrene, noted over the left fourth toe extending up to the proximal interphalangeal joint with hyperesthesia over the line of demarcation. Over the tip of the third left toe, there's a gangrenous area of 0.5 to 0.5 centimeters noted. Area surrounding the gangrene is normal with no crepitus. No cord-like thickening or tenderness noted over the course of the superficial vein. The calf circumference on both left and right lower limbs were equal and thigh circumference was also equal, suggesting no muscle volume loss or wasting. Sensory and motor examination was noted to be within normal limits and no inguinal lymphadenopathy was seen. In peripheral pulse examination, all the pulses were palpated for, flow assessed with a handheld Doppler, and AB ankle brachial pressure index was calculated and Bruhi auscultated for. As seen in the table, starting from the upper limb and progressing downwards, subclavian common carotid and all the upper limb arteries were palpable. The blood pressure was measured in both the upper limbs and was noted to be 130/78 at both the limbs. On progressing down to the lower limb, in the left lower limb, popliteal artery, anterior tibial, posterior tibial and the dorsalis pedis artery, all four were not palpable, whereas on the right lower limb, all were palpable. On proceeding with doing an ankle brachial pressure index, in the anterior tibial artery, the pressure was noted to be 40, in posterior tibial 50 and dorsalis pedis artery 40, and giving an ABI of 0.38 in the left lower limb, whereas right lower limb gave us an ABI of 1. On auscultation, reactive hyperemia test, a red flush was not noted over the left lower limb. No Bruhi was able to auscultate. On right lower limb examination, thorough examination was found to be normal. Systemic examination, cardiovascular system, S1, S2 was heard, no murmurs or added sounds were heard. Respiratory system, bilateral air entry is equal with no added sounds. Central nervous system, there's no focal neurological deficits, and on further examination of peripheral nervous system also, no motor system or sensory system deficits noted. Per abdomen, the abdomen was soft, no organomegaly, no palpable expansile mass or thrill, and no Bruhi auscultated, giving us a provisional diagnosis of a 60-year-old male smoker with hypertension and diabetes, a case of peripheral vascular disease with critical limb ischemia affecting the left lower limb, involving the femoropopliteal segment with ischemic gangrene of left third and fourth toe, Rutherford category 6, Fontaine stage 4, most probably due to atherosclerotic vascular disease.
Atherosclerotic vascular disease, was it involves the terminal vessels very often like this?
She is cross smoker for 2 years. How do you call it atherosclerotic?
Sir, apart from the smoking, he's also got a history of hypertension as well as diabetes. Okay. Generally, if
atherosclerotic is clinical examination, and atherosclerotic vessel is usually on the higher side, no? Sir, the major vessels are the first kind of targets. Larger vessels are medium vessels. You come to the periphery and they are involved.
Sir, but the
patient is a smoker. Patient is comer, is bound to have atherosclerosis. He's going to have atherosclerosis.
Just because he's diabetic and hypertensive may not always have atherosclerotic disease. You have to give the history weightage definitely. But what about your clinical examination?
No, the other point is, we don't do a clinical vascular examination unless in a specialized vascular department with a handheld Doppler. This should be a clinical examination where you have done everything about that. It should have a clinically palpable disease. You have done an ankle bucket Doppler, you are given the values. No, that's not the right way to examine a case clinically. You should not have, the investigation should follow us later. It's a specialized center, now we are only on a entry level. So we should have done a clinical examination, and based on the clinical examination only your diagnosis would have been there. But you are using a Doppler to diagnose the flow. How would you say that? A vessel is not palpable, then you are using a Doppler to confirm your flow. No, if you have already done a confirmation information. That should not be done. I'm not saying no, but it may be protocol in a vascular department, but not in a general surgery.
Okay,
in a general surgery, you must say clinically what is there. And you see, down the popliteal, all the small and the medium vessels are involved, history of smoking, diabetes, hypertension. You still want to call it an atherosclerotic disease.
Sir,
two
differential diagnoses can be...
I'm asking. Okay. Patients, 45 packages of smoking, and classically has a claudication pain, a rest pain which comes down.
Sir,
very suggestive of an TAO and angiotensin oblaterans. You still want to do?
Sir,
smoking causes occlusion of arteries.
Ma'am, smoking has nicotinic acid, and with that there is carboxyhemoglobin formation. That itself causes vasospasm, which eventually the vessel becomes thrombosed slowly. And that is how the disease progresses.
Thrombosed or rigid?
Sir,
thrombosed or rigid? The vessel becomes rigid or thrombosed? Thrombosis comes
rigid.
Later.
Rigid, sir. Later on.
Why does it, I think her question is, why does it become rigid?
Because of.
Where is the damage?
Yeah,
okay, let's go in a reverse fashion. Very nicely presented, there is no doubt about it. What is ultimately at the end of your diagnosis, what is going to be the aim of your treatment?
The main part of the aim is first to identify what is the etiological cause of the peripheral vascular disease.
How is it going to differ? Patient already has gangrene.
Sir, but
irrespective of the cause, you want to increase the vascular supply.
Yes, sir. So, but in atherosclerosis, or even if it's Burgess, in atherosclerosis, we can at least consider for a revascularization procedure. Whereas in Burgess, we'll
see,
start
that's,
with...
That has to have a principle.
Yes, sir.
I'm supposed to attend a wedding. Whose wedding it is will decide what dress I'm going to wear. Aim is to attend the wedding. Your aim is to increase the supply. Number one. Number two, by increasing the supply, you are going to decrease the pain, or you have to relieve the patient of pain. These are two basic aims of treatment of any vascular disease. So now in this patient, when your diagnosis seems to be a generalized vascular disease, a small vessel disease, which possibly is not correctable because it's already gangrene, now you tell me how are you going to treat this patient? See, ultimately, you have to lead the examiner. Don't let the examiner lead you. Moment that happens, you start going on the back foot. Okay? Go ahead.
Sir, we'd go in for investigations that would first help us in the diagnosis, which we divide into blood investigations and specific investigations.
Blood investigations are normal. Now?
In specific investigations, first and foremost, we'd go in for a Doppler. Or duplex ultrasound.
That too you have already done without trying to palpate for the vessels. You have already done Doppler.
No, so we palpated for the same, but as you have correctly said, we'd go in for an ABPI if we had not done it prior. An ankle brachial pressure index would be done along with the Doppler.
So that is there. Left side, yes. It's bad. Below popliteal, it is bad.
Yes.
Now what?
After that, we would, after checking the renal parameters, we'd like to go in for a CT angiogram of the lower limb vessels.
What additional information you are trying to get by doing a CT angiogram in this patient?
I would like to see the site of the occlusion, the vessel that is involved, whether it is the site of the vessel. The site of the occlusion, the vessel which is involved, the length of the occlusion, and whether there is a good distal run-in and a good runoff. Because if I'm...
Very nice answer. I am giving you answer.
Okay.
Distal popliteal block,
okay, sir.
Very poor runoff,
okay, sir.
No collateralization, and the vessels are very poor downstairs, right up to the foot. Now treat.
Right up to the foot, it is,
yes,
completely poor.
Yes.
There's no,
no hope.
Sir, first...
Sir is not the treatment.
No, I'm continuing, sir, after that. Distal runoff is poor.
So again, the principles of treatment become the same. You want to try and improve supply as much as possible. There is nothing surgically or by intervention. Nowadays, yes, there are people who try to do distal vascular anastomosis without success, but otherwise conservative treatment of this patient.
So conservative treatment, starting with just general measures, pharmacological therapy.
So tell
general
see
measures,
now, be specific.
Stop
Don't
smoking.
Start writing a theory answer.
Okay. Stop smoking.
One.
Control of the hypertension
diabetes.
And diabetes.
Correct.
I would give start him on antiplatelet agents.
Very good.
After that, I would go towards the relief of the pain.
Or very nice.
If I'm suspecting Burgess, I get a diagnosis.
Now,
I can go for
don't go back. No ifs and buts. No ifs and buts. You are through with the diagnosis. You are absolutely on the correct line. Okay. Now, don't take a turn. You are getting into no entry zone if by taking a turn. Okay. Very nice. Now, last thing that remains is treatment of that gangrenous toe. How will you treat that? Be brave. Be brave. Don't be afraid of people sitting here. What have you done in the ward for such a patient?
Reamputation of that person.
You have done reamputation? I will agree. If you have done it. If the patient refuses treatment, what will you do? It's a dry gangrene.
Leave it as is and give pain relief for the patient, sir.
Make sure it doesn't get infected.
Infected.
So to make sure that, because otherwise it's going to fall off on its own. To make sure it doesn't get infected, rest of the measures you have already done, control of diabetes, etc. Locally, what will you advise the patient?
Not to cover the wound, sir.
Loudly, loudly.
Not to cover the wound, sir.
Not to?
Cover the gangrenous part.
Number one. And protect it. How does one protect a dry gangrenous part of the limb?
The change of footwear.
Change of footwear. Tell me something more about the footwear to prevent injury.
So increased heel pads.
Loudly,
loudly. Footwear with an increased heel, sir.
Footwear with a?
High heels.
High heels.
Increased
heels. How will you protect the two toes which are gangrenous of a given patient? How does one, suppose you get injury, not gangrene, injury to this finger. How will you protect it?
Reduce the usage of that finger.
Protect it by surrounding so that there is no additional trauma. So while cooking, if this finger gets injured, you use these fingers, correct? Yes. Similarly, when you advise a footwear to this patient, the footwear should be one size bigger, surrounded by cotton. The cotton should be changed once it gets compressed completely, and walk slowly, consciously, to prevent injury. That finishes the treatment. One day the toe is going to fall off. In case the toe shows signs of infection, then your amputation, etc., may have to come into picture if antibiotics don't work. You understand? So I have concepts very clear. Treatment of peripheral vascular disease can be as difficult as easy, depending on how you go about treating the patient. Okay? I know that you know all interventions. I know if I ask you a question, it will come out. I don't want. Remember all of you all. Remember, you are working for 3 years as resident doctors in ward, toiling hard. And unfortunately, at the time of examination, you forget all that you have done in the ward and start talking theory. That is the biggest bugbear that can happen. Okay? All the best. Very nice.
Thank you, sir.
All the best.
Now I request Dr. Abhay Dalvi, sir, to honor our panelists with the certificates.